He has various publications in index journals. He is also an elected member of the Tamil Nadu Medical Council. Dr.S.Dhalapathy.
Thanks for the nice words, sir. It's a privilege to be faculty in our IMI Court of Home Branch. For the next 20 to 25 minutes, we will run through what is parathyroid and what challenges we face during parathyroid surgery. Because as we think that parathyroid disease is not uncommon, as previously thought, it's really common. So it's a common endocrine disorder. Actually, it was way described operate 100 years back. And the classic description of bone stones, growths and moles have changed a lot now. Now it's a disease of asymptomatic primary hyperparathyroidism, where you get certain neuropsychiatric disturbances and even suicidal thoughts. Even most of the latest studies show that suicidal tendencies are due to primary hyperparathyroidism, where the calcium level is not only high in the blood but also in the cerebrospinal fluid. So as such, now suicidal tendencies is an indication for primary hyperparathyroidism surgery. So that's a changing profile of primary hyperparathyroidism of late. As I said previously, in India we have more of these stones and bone disease, but more than 95% in the Western world or the high income countries, they have this asymptomatic or otherwise called as minimally symptomatic primary hyperparathyroidism. So it has changed drastically, and even now in here in our country we get lot of these screen detected, otherwise routine calcium screening we detect so many of these primary hyperparathyroidism, and it's, again I stress, it is not an uncommon disorder. So the most common commonly it is due to a single gland disease, as otherwise called a single adenoma, and 50 to 20% is due to a multiglandular disease or a two gland disease, otherwise called a double adenoma. So parathyroid carcinoma and other things contribute to less than 1% of this rare or uncommon disorder. So, as I said, single gland disease is always called adenoma, is a pathological diagnosis. It's not a clinical diagnosis or a working diagnosis. So, we need to tell it as a primary hyperparathyroidism due to a single gland disease. So, when we call an abnormal parathyroid intraoperatively, so most of the surgeons here would be doing a thyroidectomy, when to suspect whether the parathyroid, what we are seeing, is normal or abnormal. So, a normal parathyroid would be less than 3 to 4 millimeter. We must not calculate the fat that is surrounding the parathyroid. That will be more, as age increases, the intra cytoplasmic as well as extracellular fat around the parathyroid also increases. That is not parathyroid. Parathyroid is, will be embedded within the fat as age increases. When we operate in a children or a neonate, we will be, the parathyroid will be clearly translucent. Aware of them. So coming on, so the diagnosis of primary hyperparathyroidism is basically biochemistry, not imaging as system EPR ultrasound. Therefore, all localizing techniques that would help in identifying the offending tumor. So again, I stress, diagnosis is basically and primarily by biochemical diagnosis. That is increased calcium level with inappropriately elevated parathormone levels. This form the diagnosis for primary hyperparathyroidism, and if we do a phosphorus level, it will be low in primary hyperparathyroidism. So yeah, high or normal calcium can be there. The normal calcium might be due to associated vitamin D deficiency. So if you want to rule out any person of a primary hyperparathyroidism, we need to do calcium, phosphorus, albumin has to be done, because albumin can affect the values of calcium, because most of the calcium is bound to albumin. So albumin has to be done, creatinine also has to be done, and parathormo. These are the 5 investigations that has to be done to rule out whether the patient has primary hyperparathyroidism or not. Just doing a calcium alone will not suffice to rule out whether a patient is having PHPT or not, because most of our Indian population are vitamin D deficient, so the calcium will be normal. So in spite of the patient having a PHPT, the calcium will be normal and will be, that's a false negative value of calcium. So at least we must do a calcium under PTH to rule out a PHPT. So once we have a biochemical diagnosis of a PHPT, then we think of whether it's a single gland disease or a multi-gland disease. So for the operative planning, these modalities like imaging will help, not for a diagnosis. Even if the modalities like systemic B scan or ultrasound or 4DCT, whatever, they are negative, if the primary or biochemical diagnosis is primary hyperparathyroidism, we need to operate. And because surgery is the main standard of care for PHPT, only in case of very old persons where surgery is contraindicated, even then we can do these surgeries under local anesthesia. Even that is not possible, then we will go for medical management. That is just for buying time, like operate calcium sensing receptor modulators like selective. So ultrasound, though we know that it's an operator dependent and has a varying sensitivity from 80 to 90%, and systemic scan will pick up only around 80 to 85% of these tumors. It is more sensitive in single gland disease, that is single gland is otherwise called adenomas, and very ineffective in case of multiglandular disease. So where we really want these modalities to work, they will not work. That is, we need to identify this multiglandular disease, these imaging modalities fail, rather than it works in a single gland disease where it is easy to identify this. So treatment options, we know medical treatment as well as surgical, and surgery is the mainstay of treatment, again I stress. So approach is a conventional bilateral neck exploration where you look for the parathyroid, because as before I go into it, there are not only 4 parathyroids, the maximum 13 parathyroids have been documented. Less than 1% will have 3 parathyroids. If 4 parathyroids are present only around 80% of the population. So another 15 to 20% of the population will have a supernumerary parathyroid or a 5th parathyroid. So 6 parathyroids, something like that, it can be there. But as a common, 80% of the population will have 4 parathyroids. This is not this is useful because in case of a secondary hyperparathyroidism or a multiglandular disease, all the parathyroids will be involved. So we need to take care of not only the 4 parathyroids where we usually look for, the other parathyroid or ectopic sites or the undescended sites where these parathyroids can be located. So your surgeon has to be well versed with the embryology of the parathyroid rather than the anatomy of the parathyroid. So it's an embryology based surgery rather than an anatomical based surgery. So conventionally it was started with the bilateral neck exploration, then it changed to unilateral exploration, and of late most of the cases are done by minimally invasive approach. Minimally invasive can, is, otherwise it's not a single term, it can be done under various procedures like selective parathyroidectomy. That means put a 2 cm incision over the appendic tumor, do a ultrasound before surgery, again localize the tumor, put the incision just over the parathyroid tumor, just remove it. Here you are not seeing the other normal parathyroids. Or you can go by a remote access or endoscopic path. That's also a minimally invasive approach. There you are not looking the other parathyroids. But in case of a bilateral exploration, you are inspecting all the 4 parathyroids morphologically in our eye. So just I will go through a few cases where, so that it will be easier to comprehend how that's different. So this is one case where the tectonic localization. Tectonic means one is a anatomical imaging, another is a functional imaging. Ultrasound is an anatomical imaging, CT is an anatomical imaging. Systemic scan or tetraphosphamine scan is a functional imaging, otherwise a nuclear medicine based imaging. So if both are localizing the same tumor, suppose to be superior parathyroid. So that is called a concordant imaging. If both are there, then you can go for a minimally invasive parathyroidectomy. That is clear? 2 cm incision over the affecting tumor. But that has an accuracy rate of around 99.5%. Still, 0.5%, that's a possibility the tumor can be a multiglandular disease or a double adenoma. Even if both are concordant. This one case where concordant location is the retrosternal one. The patient had a severe bone disease. Actually, this lady, sorry, this girl lost around 12 cm of her height because of the repeated fractures over the spine as well as everything. And her pH was around more than 2000 and her calcium was 11, not so high because of the vitamin D deficiency associated with that. So, ultrasound localized the inferior parathyroid tumor and systemic was also locating the same. So it was a concordant imaging. So because of our young age, because young age are more prone for genetic transmission of this disease, because male one, that is multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, familial isolated primary hyperparathyroidism, multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, all these occur, especially in the young, they present in the younger age. So less than 40 years, better to go for a foreground exploration rather than a minimally invasive approach, because it's a matter of 2 cm incision. Here you, we go with the 2 cm incision, here 4 cm, so it's a matter of only 2 cm, but we are able to see all the 4 parathyroids instead of seeing only the appending tumor that's localized. So here you can see the right inferior parathyroid tumor, which was going retrosternally. So here we see the normal other parathyroid also because of the younger age, take a biopsy and take it out. So this is the second case that the high calcium was detected by a routine screen. It was non-localized, both ultrasound as well as SBP. Though it was non-localized, we would still try to go for surgery because, as I said, the diagnosis is basically by biochemistry. So here, this is SBP which was negative, ultrasound also negative. So intraoperative, you can see the parathyroid which was on the right superior one. That was the thyroid lobe. This is the thyroid and this is the parathyroid, which was missed both by the ultrasound as well as the system EB scan. So you need to see the nerve. Usually, normally the superior parathyroids will be posterior to the recurrent laryngeal nerve and the inferior parathyroids will be anterior to the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So this is another case where concordant imaging was there in a recurrent pancreatitis patient. Other thing, during pancreatitis, the calcium level, if you see, the calcium level will be normal in case of a primary hyperparathyroidism, because the supplementation of the pancreas due to the mobilization of the calcium from the blood to the pancreas. So during the acute attack, attack of pancreatitis, if we see, the calcium will be normal. But after the attack of pancreatitis, the calcium will again rise. So during the time also, PTH only will help rather than the calcium in this setting. So this, she had pancreatitis and calculus also, PTH was 486 and it was concordant. So we remove. So why I want to say this, calcium can be normal in this type of setting or pancreatitis, that I want to emphasize in this. So this another case that who presented with hypercalcemic crisis. So as a 70-year-old lady that has presented with coma and a severe dehydration and persistent vomiting. So her calcium was 20, which is not uncommon in case of hypercalcemic crisis. Hypercalcemic crisis by definition means calcium level more than 14, but also must have symptoms of this hypercalcemia. Not only with the biochemical, even the calcium is 20. The patient doesn't have any symptoms of hypercalcemia, then it is not hypercalcemic crisis. Both the biochemically, the calcium has to be high, as well as symptoms of hypercalcemia like vomiting, nausea, dehydration, all this with the hypotension or coma must be associated with that to label the person who have a hypercalcemic crisis. So again, you need to check that PTH was, you can see, nearing 4000. So the systemic scan showed right side uptake. Ultrasound also showed a right side uptake. Intraoperatively, it was not a single tumor, it was a double adenoma. So what I want to say is, intraoperative, there can be so much of surprises in case of parathyroid lesions. So it was a double adenoma in this type of patient where even ultrasound system we were not able to tell preoperatively. So post-op became normal. This is another case where patient, that's a doctor's mother actually, present with multiple fractures. Why I want to tell this, even it is not uncommon in doctors to miss these type of tumors. She had so much of fractures, so many times fractures, which have been seen by orthopedicians with internal fixation of both the feet, tibia, and with the jaw tumors, you can see the down tumor of the mandible here. And the calcium was 10.6. Because the vitamin D is less than 4, you can see. But PTH was around 400. So the systemic is, it was close to the left side. And ultrasound was normal. So we went ahead with surgery. And it was not a simple tumor. It was a multiglandular disease. The left superior, left inferior, and the right inferior, all the three parathyroids were enlarged. So it was a multiglandular disease which was missed also. And post-operatively the patient became normal. And as I said, young patients, which is not uncommon to have this genetic transmission with MEN1. That's a menin gene attack. This is a family who had prolactinoma and has been on treatment with cabergoline. On routine calcium screening, calcium was found to be high. And PTH was not so high. 163. Here, in case of this genetically transmitted PHPT, the calcium as well as PTH will be less severe than the sporadic cases. So calcium will not be so high or PTH will not be so high in this type of genetically transmitted PHPTs. So here also it was not so concurrent. And here we need to do a 3.5 lung parathyroidectomy and remove the thymus also, because the thymus is removed in this because the, as I said, 50 to 20% will have a supernumerary parathyroid, not with the parathyroid. So that will be in the thyrothermic ligament or within the thymus. So we need to remove the thymus through the neck, that's transcervical thymectomy. So in this, we will do 3.5 lung parathyroidectomy and leave a normal size remnant, that is 1 cm of this parathyroid with a non-absorbable suture or a metal clip, so that anyhow, that tissue will again regrow, but it will take 20 years, 25 years to reach a critical level. Till that, at that time, to identify that tumor, we'll mark it with a non-absorbable suture or a metal clip. So we mark this. So this was a 3.5 lung parathyroidectomy with a thymectomy. And actually, three of her kidneys have this primary hyperpara, all underwent the same procedure. And genetic mutation is also positive in this family. So this is a 5-month-old where the calcium will be, we can see 20, 22, it was rising like that. This is called neonatal severe primary hyperparathyroidism. As of late, we have operated 4 cases of this neonatal severe primary hyperpara. And of late, just 1 month back, we operated one child at ICH. It was a neonate, 22 days old, 22 days old. The baby was weighing only 1.9 kg. Had a calcium level of 30. So in these cases, we need to do a total parathyroidectomy and a thymectomy, because we need to make these babies a parathyroid, because these babies usually die at the time of birth if it's not treated. They usually present with failure to thrive and hypotonia, severe hypotonia. So this is one of the cases where we did a... So we need to search in this type of case. What's challenging is we need to look for all the areas where the parathyroid tissue descends or can be found, because we can't afford to miss any amount of parathyroid tissue in the neck or the mediastinum. So we need to make these babies or children a parathyroid, that is totally free of parathyroid tissue. So they will have a, here you can, we did a total parathyroidectomy with the thymectomy. So, so the thymus which was removed, so what all tissues we suspect as parathyroid removed. So postoperative calcium came to normal. And we did a genetic mutation of, for this, and we found a novel mutation in this boy. Actually, he was diagnosed at 5 months of, but when he was referred to us for surgery, he was around 5 years. But the other 3 babies which you operated was around 22 days, another was a 1.5 month old, another was a 3 month old. So, 3-4 cases we have this neonatal severe primary hyperparathyroidism. So, this is the case where the calcium is high, and this is both the system beep and ultrasound was concurrent. But even with concurrent, this was the around 30 years old girl, all four parathyroids were developed without any syndromic association. So that can also be a possibility. So it was a multiglandular disease. So ectopic sites, as I said, this can, this will happen in an 8-year-old girl who presented the thyroid nodule. Ultrasound showed it was a right side thyroid nodule. Even FNAC was saying only it was a nodule and biter. But intraoperatively, you can see it was a, this was something present the right side thyroid nodule. Intraoperatively, it was a right thyroid nodule which we removed it. Right hemithyroidectomy was done. Postoperatively, it was a with branchial cyst, not a parathyroid, with parathyroid and thymic tissue. So this was a embryological surprise or histological surprise where you have a branchial cyst in the thyroid gland with the parathyroid as well as a thymic tissue. So this, this parathyroid tissue, again enlarges along with this, this may cause a primary hyperparathyroid. Another case where concurrent and ultrasound as well as system may be planned for a minimal invasive parathyroidectomy. Next. So it's a 2 cm incision. Again, next. But it was not in the area of parathyroid, it was within the carotid sheath. This tumor was within the carotid sheath, though it was concurrent and saying it was a little inferior one. We did not find that in that inferior area, whatever it's concurrent area. Rather than near the carotid sheath was there. When we opened the carotid sheath, we found that tumor within, between the carotid artery and internal jugular vein. Next. You can see the carotid artery and jugular vein, which was embedded deep. Next. So, this is next. So, reoperative surgeries are not uncommon. Next. This was operated. She was not cured of hyperparathyroidism. So again, operator, next. We did take her for surgery. Next. So only all areas we searched, the parathyroid tissue was not found, only the remnant hemithyroidectomy specimen was there. So we palpated it, there was something hard within the thyroid lobe, so we removed it. Next. So it has an intrathyroidal parathyroid, so it is not uncommon. It can be from the superior or inferior parathyroid to go in, into the thyroid and cause this type of thing. Next. This was presented as a parathyroid malignancy where hypercalcemic encephalopathy. Calcium was high. Next. So this was a parathyroid carcinoma which can cause very high levels of calcium and hypercalcemic crisis is more common in case of parathyroid carcinoma. Next, any heart tumor, and you need to do a wide local excision with a hemithyroidectomy with or without central compartment lymph node dissection at the primary attempt itself. So, intraoperatively, you suspect more of a parathyroid carcinoma, we can suspect it intraoperatively. So, it will be hard and whitish rather than a soft adenomas or hyperplasia.
Next.
So, before. So, as of now, have around 276 parathyroidectomies, and we did compare with group 1 and group 2, and we found that the number of parathyroids were more in the younger age group rather than the older age group, and hyperplasias are more common in the younger than in the older one. Next. So, as I said, it's a epidemiology based surgery rather than anatomy based surgery. Next. So, the superior parathyroids are symmetrical only 80% and inferior parathyroids are symmetrical in 60% of the cases. Most of the time they will be within thyrothymic ligament or tract. Next. So, asymmetry is not uncommon. We need to look for the supernumerary parathyroid, the fifth or elusive parathyroid, which can be there. Next. So, to conclude, the top man is a radiologist. So, that means he has told in 1968 itself, the only thing to localize in primary hyperparathyroidism is an experienced parathyroid surgeon. This statement still holds true, even with the latest sophisticated imaging techniques still available. Thanks a lot. Be happy to take any queries. Actually, as I said, we need to explore from the angle of the mandible, the carotid sheath, in the thoracic inlet.
What is identification?
Parathyroids, actually, you need to get used to seeing these parathyroids. Morphologically, it will be in the region of, it will be crystal clear and it will be away, separate from the thyroid. But you need to, again, I say, needs a lot of experience to pick up these small parathyroids. Definitely, sir. Most of these patients will develop hypocalcemia. That is called, that depends on the various factors. That depends on the preoperative, how much the calcium, how much of bone loss is there preoperatively, whether the patient is having a hungry bone syndrome because of this, or if you do a, because all the other parathyroids should be suppressed. In a single gland disease, if you remove this, the other parathyroid will be suppressed. It takes time for the other parathyroids to again secrete the parathormone. So, 50 to 60% of these patients will undergo or need calcium supplementation, some need IV calcium supplementation for weeks also. That depends on the bone mineral density. If we do preoperative the bone mineral density, we will know the T score and the Z score. That will reflect whether the patient or the person require a calcium supplementation in the post operative period.
Father has neuroendocrine
carcinoma of the gastroenteritis tract is associated with the Meynold syndrome. Meynold. In that case, if it's a Meynold syndrome, 100% will have a primary hyperpara. 50% will have this neuroendocrine tumors of the gastroenteritis. Yes.
Serum fat thermal PTH level is concerned. Based on serum level of parathyroid level, will you say it's primary or secondary?
Not on, as I told, not only on PTH, even suppose vitamin D deficiency or PTH, if you see, PTH will be increased, it will be around 200. That is due to vitamin D deficiency. That is a secondary to vitamin D deficiency. So you must have a calcium level high or normal calcium with low vitamin D with inappropriately high PTH. In that case, if you still suspect that it's due to vitamin D deficiency, the PTH, what you need to do is replace the vitamin D, again check for the calcium and vitamin PTH after 6 weeks' time. In that case, the calcium will again rise if it is not due to vitamin D deficiency.
Level to say above which it is primary, not like that.
No.
That level Suppose we get 1000 flight at
normal. It is not based on the level. It can be, for surgical indication, it has to be more than 1 milligram above the upper reference range of the value of calcium. But to label that as a PHPT, that's not cut off like that.
Thank you.
During thyroidectomy, do the surgeons accidentally remove the parathyroid
section in some patients who have passed? No, sir. Actually, there are four parathyroid. Even if that, what we routinely do is we take out the parathyroid during surgery, routinely auto transplant in the sternocleidomastoid mastoid muscle so that the permanent hypocalcemia does not occur. Before proceeding for thyroidectomy, I routinely take a parathyroid, auto transplant in the sternocleidomastoid muscle, then proceed for thyroidectomy. Even if you remove all the four parathyroids or three parathyroids inadvertently, even if you preserve the parathyroids, vascularity of parathyroid is very important because it's the end arterial supply. It doesn't have any aspect. So if the vascularity is complete, goes into a spasm or in that case, even if you preserve the parathyroid, it will not be functional. So better always to auto-transplant a parathyroid. If you remove inadvertent parathyroid, then you please auto-transplant it. Put in an ice cold saline, mince it as fine as possible, take in a 1 ml of saline syringe, then you just inject it into the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Always after removing the thyroidectomy system, you have to look for the any inadvertent parathyroid has been removed with the thyroid. So that if it is there, you need to auto transplant it.
Dear members, today the purpose of Dr. Dhalapathy coming here is something different. For what I suggested, the office where.